December 7th, 1992. Whidbey Island, Puget Sound. The world wars were over. The other wars were over. Korea, Vietnam. The Cold War was finally over, too. The Whidbey Island Naval Air Station remained. At the Naval Air Station, the infinite Pacific appeared as finite data gathered by a network of hydrophones spread along the ocean floor. Initially used to monitor Soviet subs during the Cold War, these hydrophones had since been turned toward the sea itself, transforming its formless noises into something measurable. Pages of printed graphs rolling out of a spectrograph machine. On that particular December day in 1992, Petty Officer Second Class Velma Ronkiel heard a strange sound. She stretched it out on a different spectrogram so she could see it better. She couldn't quite believe that it was coming in at 52 hertz. She beckoned one of the audio technicians. He needed to come back, she said. He needed to take another look. The technician came back. He took another look. Velma told him, I think this is a whale.
One thing that I believe pretty fully about every project, and this applies to every essay, is that if it doesn't feel hard in some way, if it doesn't feel like I'm doing something new or something intimidating or even a little bit frightening, like I'm probably doing something wrong. So I think it's fair to say that every essay was hard in a good way. I think that the first essay, which is an essay called 52 Blue about this whale that came to be known as the loneliest whale in the world, I would say that was probably the hardest essay. I spent about 18 months in total reporting it, re-reporting it, crafting it, sculpting it, figuring out what I had to say. And part of what was difficult about it was that it was one of the first really fully reported pieces I ever wrote. So in a way, I was learning how to be a journalist as I was writing it and dealing with things like one of the central researchers who had been studying this whale. I had this grand vision that she was going to give me all of the letters that she had received from people over the years who had become obsessed with this whale and identified with the whale and projected their loneliness onto the whale. But she had no interest in talking to me. She had no interest in sharing her letters with me. And this was like one of my first major encounters with just like a very ordinary part of journalism, which is being rejected by your subjects. I really had to figure out what do you do when you like come up with all of your desires and all of your curiosities against some kind of wall. And in this case, you know, it just meant that I had to find my own way of reaching all of these people who are out there and who are yearning and who are wonderful, who are obsessed with this whale. And so I had to find my way to them. And once I did find my way to them, it meant that I had this sense of like even deeper connection and even deeper investment because I had put in these months of sort of effort and attempt.
They weren't typical pieces of professional correspondence. They came, as New York Times reporter Andrew Revkin wrote at the time, from whale lovers lamenting the notion of a lonely heart of the cetacean world, or from people who identified with the whale for other reasons, because he seemed restless or independent, because he sang his own song. These letters came from the heartbroken and the deaf, from the lovelorn and the single, the once bitten, twice shy, and the twice bitten, forever shy. People who identified with the whale or hurt for him, ached for whatever set of feelings they projected onto him. A legend was born, the loneliest whale in the world.
Hachette,